فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We were speaking about the four a'immatul arba'a and about their madhabs. We spoke about Imam Abu Hanifa and his madhab, and the terms and the mustalahat which are khasah, that are specific to the madhab. We also spoke about Imam Malik rahimahullah, and we also spoke about Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala's biography. We also spoke about his madhabs, the well-known imams of the madhab al-Malikiyah. We also did the same for the madhab al-Shafi'iyah, terms that are used within the madhab when they say al-aqwal, al-awju, al-turuq. What do they mean by those? Inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to speak about al-madhab al-Hanbali. Today we're going to be speaking about the Hanbali madhab. And as we always do it, we do at-ta'rifu bi-imam al-madhab. We actually speak about the imam of the madhab. We define him, we speak about his biography, and then we move on to the madhab. So who is the imam of the madhab? Who is the imam of the madhab? And this is the last of the four imams. He is the last of the four imams, according to Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. He is al-imam Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal ibn Shaybani al-Shaybani wa Abu Abdullah. It's Ahmad ibn Muhammad. Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal, ibn Shayban, Abu Abdullah is his kunya. And Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, his birth was fi Rabi' al-Awwal. He was born in Rabi' al-Awwal, Imam Ahmad, when the year was 164. And some said, no, it was actually Rabi' al-Akhir. So as you can see, many people refer to Imam Ahmad and they say Hanbal. Hanbal is his granddad. His father's name is Muhammad. Imam Ahmad was an imam, and he kana imaman fil hadith. He was an imam in hadith. إماما في السنة is an imam in sunnah. إماما في الفقه is an imam in fiqh. Imam Ahmad. شهد له معاصروه. The scholars that were at that time with him, they testified to that. بالإمامة في الحديث, that is an imam in hadith, that is an imam in fiqh. And they also testified to him بالتقدم في الفقه, that Ahmad was the forefront in fiqh. They testified that for to him. So we don't take into consideration, my beloved brothers and sisters, لا عبرة بزعم بعض المتأخرين, the late scholars who came after, who then started to say Imam Ahmad محدث وليس بفقيه. Ahmad's only a محدث, he's not a faqih. لا عبرة بزعمهم. Those that claim of their, there's no, we don't take that on board. We don't give it any consideration. The reality of the matter is, the reason why those who say that Ahmad was not a faqih, he was not a jurist, he was not from the fuqaha, and he was only a muhaddith, those who say that, they say that because that he was asked questions. Ahmad questions were presented to Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. And when the questions were presented to him, Ahmad rahimahullah responded by saying, haddathana. He would bring a chain for it. Every time they ask him a question, he would bring a hadith for it. He would narrate it with a hadith. They said, فَأُثِرَ عَنْهُ أَنَّهُ سُئِلَ عَنْ 60,000 مَسْأَلَةً. 60,000 questions have been put to Imam Ahmad. Each and every one of them he answered with حَدَّثَنَا. all of the questions, he brought athar for it. He brought statements for it. So they said from there, إِنَّهُ مُحَدِّثٌ وَلَيْسَ بِفَقِيهِ, that he's a muhaddith and he's not a faqih. That's what they said. And this we said is a za'm batil. That's a, the word, what does za'm mean by the way? Za'm is, it means matiyatul kadib. It's a matiyatul kadib. It's a claim. It's nothing that's baseless. It's a baseless argument. Rather, Ahmad rahimahullah, using hadith for questions that have been asked to him, shows his quwwatul istinbat. Rather, it shows his fiqh. It shows the opposite of what you're denying. That Ahmad rahimahullah, that his knowledge of hadith and how he dealt with the textual evidences was so strong that he was able, rahimahullah ta'ala, to use dalil for himself in 60,000 questions and know that this dalil is the evidence for him in this particular issue. That shows that he's a faqih, rahimahullah, and that he's from the fuqaha al-kibar. The a'imma of his time, the imams who, they, these people who say that Imam Ahmad was not a faqih, those who say Imam Ahmad is not a faqih, but they would say other scholars are fuqaha. They would testify to other scholars being fuqaha. Those scholars who they would consider fuqaha would say Ahmad is a faqih. For example, Ibrahim al-Harbi, who died in 285. His name is Ibrahim al-Harbi. Ibrahim al-Harbi, he said, أَدْرَكْتُ ثَلَاثَةً, I met three, تَعْجِزُ النِّسَاءَ يَلِدْنَ مِثْلَهُمْ, I met three mothers have become tired from giving birth the likes of them. Three T people I met. Mothers are unable to give the birth the likes of them. Mothers can't have them, can't have him. They can't have these three individuals. The first one is Ra'aytu Aba Ubaid. I saw Aba Ubaid. Abu Ubaid Qasim ibn Salam. فَمَا مَثَّلْتُهُ إِلَّا بِجَبَلٍ نُفِخَتْ فِيهِ الرُّوحِ, I did not, Abu Ubaid was the first one I saw, I did not compare him to, except a mountain in which ruh was blown into it. Meaning, in other words, he's still, he's solid. Abu Ubaid Qasim ibn Salam, the first one I met, is like a mountain that has been blown into it, ruh. The way he's solid and he's strong, he doesn't move. And he's tough. In his ilm, of course. وَرَأَيْتُ, I saw Bishr ibn al-Harith. The second, I saw Bishr ibn al-Harith. فَمَا شَبَّهْتُ, I did not compare him to, إِلَّا بِرَجُلٍ, except a man. عُجِلَ مِنْ قَرْنِهِ إِلَى قَدَمِهِ عَقْلًا, that from the top to the bottom of his feet, Allah filled him with aql, smart, very intellectual person, full of wisdom. وَرَأَيْتُ أَحْمَدَ بْنَ حَنْبَلْ, and I saw Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. فَرَأَيْتُ كَأَنَّ اللَّهَ, I saw that this man is as though Allah قَدْ جَمَعَ لَهُ عِلْمُ الْأَوَّلِينَ, that Allah brought him all of the knowledge of those who preceded him, gave it all to him. فَمِنْ كُلِّ صِنْفٍ يَقُولُ مَا شَاءَ, each of those three I mentioned, they would say what they wanted. وَيُمْسِكُ مَا شَاءَ, they would withhold what they wanted. It's like all of the knowledge was placed in front of them, they could choose what they wanted to take, each and every one of them. So this, what does it show you? Ahmad rahimahullah was an arif bil athar, and he was a faqih rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. That statement I mentioned of Ibrahim al-Harbi, Baghdad, Khatib al-Baghdadi mentions in his kitab Tariq al-Baghdad, 12th volume, page 409. Ibn Asakir in his kitab Tariq al-Dimashq, he mentions it, the 49th volume, 69, page 69. Manaqib Imam Ahmad, page 77. Good. Ahmad rahimahullah, that's his fiqh. Ahmad rahimahullah, uthira anhu, it has been transmitted from him, annahu kana yahfadhu alfa hadith. That Ahmad memorized a million hadith. It's been transmitted from him. Khatib al-Baghdadi mentioned his kitab Tariq al-Baghdad, Ibn Asakir in Tariq Dimashq, and also in the kitab Maraqib al-Mahmud, rahimahullah ta'ala. Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Salam, who died in 224, he said, Rabbaniyul hadithi arba'ah. The Rabbanis, the godly scholars, are four in hadith, four. فَأَعْلَمُهُمْ But the most knowledgeable of those four, بِالْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ is Ahmad. There are four, but the one who's not only, he's not a Rabbani only in hadith, he just not memorized hadith, he's also more knowledgeable than the rest in al-halal wal-haram, is Ahmad rahimahullah. So this is again a testification from the Imam of his time, Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Salam, AbdulRazak ibn Hammam al-Sal'ani, who died in 207. He said, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَفْقَهَ وَلَا أَوْرَعَ مِنْ أَحْمَدِ بْنِ حَنْبَلِ عبد الرزاق بن همام الصنعاني, he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ I never saw أَحَدًا any individual أَفْقَهَ who has more fiqh وَلَا أَرْوَعَ and stays away from doubtful matters than أحمد رحمه الله تعالى الإمام الشافعي وهو هو شافعي is who شافعي is الإمام الشافعي said خرجت من بغداد. الإمام الشافعي said, I have walked away from Baghdad. I left Baghdad. فما خلفت فيها رجلا أفضل ولا أعلم ولا أفقه ولا أتقى من أحمد بن حنبل. I left Baghdad and I did not leave behind in Baghdad a man more virtuous, more knowledgeable in fiqh and more pious than Ahmad ibn Hanbal. That's his teacher. That's not his peer. That's not his student. But he's his teacher. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i said that I never left no one behind. He had many students over there. He had Abu Thawr. He had Al-Hasan ibn Muhammad. Al-Hasan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani. He also had Ahmad as a student as well. He had Al-Husayn al-Karabisi. Ahmad had many students in Iraq who took knowledge from him. But he said, I left none of those. The person I left behind in Baghdad, the most knowledgeable man, the most faqih of them all, the most pious of them all, was who? Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ishaq ibn Rahuya. And some people, they say Ishaq ibn Rahawiya, but it's best to say Rahuya. He died in the year 238. He said, Ahmad, حجة بين الله وبين خلقه. Ahmad is a proof between Allah and his creation. Ahmad is a حجة, that he's a proof from Allah against the creation. Abu Thawr, who's another alim from the students of Imam Shafi'i, look at this statement that he said about him. انظروا إلى هذه الكلمة العظيمة. This great statement of his. He said, أحمد بن حنبل أعلم أو أفقه من الثوري. Ahmad is more knowledgeable or has more fiqh than Sufyan al-Thawri. He's more fiqh than who? Sufyan al-Thawri. This is Sufyan al-Thawri. He is who he is, right? Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan al-Thawri, by the way, he had a madhab. In darasa madhabu. The madhab of Sufyan al-Thawri, it perished, it wore out. But he had a madhab. So Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, that's what the A'imah said about him. Abu Zur'at al-Razi, who died in 264 Hijriah, he said, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, akbaru min Ishaq. Abu Zur'at said this. He said, Ahmad ibn Hanbal is bigger and greater than Ishaq ibn Rahuya. Ilman wa afqah. He's greater than him in knowledge, and he is more of a faqih than he is. مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَكْمَلَ مِنْ أَحْمَدٍ I have not seen anyone more complete than Ahmad ibn Hanbal. ذهبي brings that in Sir Alam al-Nubala. Hafiz ibn Asakir brings in his kitab al-Tariqh al-Dimashq. Many scholars have testified to Ahmad's understanding of al-fiqh and knowledge. And Imam al-Dhahabi, رحمه الله, he said in Sir Alam al-Nubala, 11th volume, page 203, he said, كَانَ أَحْمَدُ عَظِيمَ الشَّأْنِ Ahmad, his affairs is great. رَأْسًا فِي الْحَدِيثِ He's a leader in hadith. وَفِي الْفِقْهِ He's also a leader in fiqh. وفي التأله in its ibadah. Ahmad also is a leader in it. أثنى عليه خلق من خصومه. Many have praised Ahmad, even from his opponents, they praised him. فما الظن بإخوانه وأقرانه. Then what do you think of his friends and his colleagues and his peers? What would they say about him? His own opponents have testified to his nobility and the status and the knowledge of Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he died في ربيع الأول. He died when it was ربيع الأول, as he was born in ربيع الأول, according to one of the opinions out there. And the year he died was 241 Hijriyah. 200 and what? 41 Hijriyah. And Ahmad rahimahullah, he said to the Ahlul Bidah, he said to them, بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ يَوْمُ الْجَنَازَةِ أَمَا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْجَنَائِزِ. Between us and you guys is the janazah. Between us and you guys is janazah. And Ahmad rahimahullah, اجتمع في جنازته خلق كثير. In the Islamic history, there was no one like his janazah, as the scholars mentioned. And Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, the people opened their doors, their houses, the people's houses became a road. People coming from one side of the house and leaving from the other. The roads got closed. The people were, arriving weeks later to the janazah of Imam Ahmad. They were coming weeks after the janazah already took place. So the people were, some of the mentioned that people would go from one house, and before they go to the other house, their wudu would break. So the distance and how long they would be in the middle. So they would do wudu in each house they went to. This is the janazah of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala. Shahida lahu al-qasi wa dani. The closest person and the ones who were far from Ahmad, who did not like him, they all testified. They all agreed. They testified to Ahmad rahimahullah, his status and his level of knowledge and piety and greatness. And the reason is because Ahmad rahimahullah, he stood up for the religion, he signified the religion, he stood up for it at a time when many chose not to. The Quran was accused of being created. It was said that this is not the speech of Allah, it is makhluq, it's created just like you're created. And Ahmad rahimahullah did not accept that. He did not, knowing that the leader would beat him, knowing that he would go behind bars. Ahmad rahimahullah showed patience and endurance. He showed what? Patience and endurance. He would faint and he would wake up, and he would get beaten again, and he would faint again, and he would wake up, and he would get beaten. The leader did not even trust anyone to beat Ahmad. He had to come down from his own qasr, his palace, and he whipped Ahmad his own self. He beat Al-Imam Ahmad physically, rahimahullah ta'ala. And it even caused Ahmad physical pain even after he came out of prison. The beating that he endured and the torture he was put through, rahimahullah ta'ala. And every time a Muslim stands up for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a'azzahullah, Allah honors him. Allah honors him. Allah puts him up. But when the person calls to deviation and he calls to corruption, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliates him and Allah extinguishes his light. But when the person stands for the sunnah and he stands for the religion of Allah, he represents it, qalban wa qaliban, externally and internally, Allah lifts him ranks. Ahmad, through that fitna, the fitna of Khalq al-Qur'an, that the Qur'an is created, he earned through it a name. A title was then given to him. No one else shared this title with him. Which was what? Imam Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah. He became the Imam of Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Why did they give him that title? Because the time when the Aqeed of Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah was being put on what? Was being put on the line. And Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah, their biggest thing for Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah is what? The Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran itself is now being accused of being created. So Ahmad rahimahullah. One of the things I read from Ahmad rahimahullah was a man came to him, a Bedouin man came to Ahmad, rahimahullah. And he said to Ahmad, rahimahullah, when Ahmad was getting, he was in prison, was getting beaten, he said to Imam Ahmad, I cut the other side of the river. I came from the other side of the river, and I only came to tell to you, I only came to say to you, Uthbut ya Ahmad. Ahmad, be firm, be steadfast on what you're on. Don't sway and leave and give up. Be firm and steadfast. If you can't be steadfast, just put the shackles on me and I would endure it more than you. And Ahmad rahimahullah said, would I give you this status, this honorable position I have gained? Will I give it to you? No. Another man came to Ahmad rahimahullah at that time. And he said to Ahmad, Ahmad, be patient. He said, I was prohibited, or he stole something, I think, or he did zina or something. And he said, I'm getting lashed for a desire I wanted, and I'm patient for the beating. I'm patient for this beating because of desires I fulfilled, haram desires. Ya Ahmad, can you not be patient for Allah's religion? Can you not be patient for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's what? Religion. And this, brothers, wallahi, when you look at Ahmad rahimahullahu ta'ala, one thing that always sticks out for me, which is what? إِيَّاكَ وَالتَّلَوُّنَ فَإِنَّ دِينَ اللَّهِ وَاحِدٍ. To be steadfast. For verily the religion of Allah is what? It's one. To just be consistent upon being steadfast from the beginning to the end of your life. Ahmad did not in any way form or shape leave. This is the hardest thing. Many people can get hyped and energetic and steadfast for a period of time. But can they carry on for long? Can they go on, still carry on? This is where many might say, no, I can't. Ahmad did, rahimahullah ta'ala. One leader died, another leader died. The third leader let him go. All of that, he's behind bars. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Some people, they attribute themselves to Imam Ahmad's madhab, rahimahullah. They attribute themselves to what? And Imam Ahmad's madhab. But they don't represent aqidah of Imam Ahmad. And Imam Ahmad, the people who beat him like that, who lashed him like that, he even said that the Qur'an is created, whoever says it is a kafir. Man qala. Anyone who says that the Qur'an is created, Ahmad said he's a kafir. And it's true. It's an ijma' of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Not two imams from Ahl Sunnah differ on that. Ahmad, when he came out of prison, he made dua for those leaders. He did not make takfir on them. He did not take them out of Islam. Ahmad, rahimahullah. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah mentions that in his Majmu' al-Fatawa. Rather, Ahmad, they took the shackles off him to do wudu. They took the shackles off him to do wudu. And Ahmad looked and he said, if only they took these shackles off us all the time, I would not leave prison, I would still obey them. When they took it off him, he said, if they tell me, stay in your prison cell and not to move, be there. He said, I will not leave. There's no need for them to put these shackles on me and these chains. Rahimahullahu rahmatan wasi'ah. And when he came out, these people, they said to him, Ahmad, we're going to revolt against these leaders. Look what they put you through. Look what they're upon. We're going to revolt against them. Ahmad said, Ad-dima, ad-dima, blood, blood. Blood, blood. In other words, when you do revolt against these individuals, they're not going to easily let you revolt. They're going to kill you. They're going to spill blood. Ahmad said, no. I don't see this except it's going to bring calamity and problems. And anyone today who looks at what happened in the Muslim world today after the, as they refer to it as what? The Arab Spring. Who are the people, this blood that shed, and the people who got killed, who's going to take it on their neck the day of judgment? Many people are going to take it. From the people who are going to take it is those who said, demonstrate and go against your leaders. The scholars that gave the fatwa and said, do this Arab Spring, it's permissible, it's allowed. Aren't they going to take it on their scale the day of judgment, the blood that shed? And the children that died in Syria? And then when the scholars at the beginning said, don't demonstrate, don't go against your leaders, the blood's going to shed, it's not going to be easy. Ad-dima, ad-dima, when the ulama said that, they were accused of being scholars of. Then when the fitna happened, they looked at those scholars, they said, what are you guys doing for your brothers in Syria? What are you doing for your brothers in what? Yeah, in the beginning you were told not to go out against your leaders, right? Were you not told? Are you there? So this blood doesn't just go hadar. This blood doesn't just spill and it's like, oh, qadarullah masha'a fa'ali, happened, what happened? There were so-called scholars who gave fatwa, who said it's permissible. Go against your leaders. Take sakakin, take little swords and knives against the babat. Against flight, planes. And now, those inefficient women and children are dying because of that. That fatwa which was fasad and corruption. Are you with me, brothers? Manhaj Ahlul Sunnah is that the istaghir, the rectification of problems and the ways things are done. Are done in what way, brothers and sisters? How is it done? It brings about khair. Ahlul Sunnah's rectification of situations is not based upon what? It's not based upon... Huh? It's not based upon calamities and corruption coming after it. The taghir of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, it brings about khair for the people and the land. They look at the matter, they look at ability. That's why it's important to go back to the ulama. هُمُ الَّذِينَ يُقَدِّرُونَ الْأَقْدَارِ. They are the ones who look at the issues and say, this is the amount that's needed, this is how it should be done, this is a fitna, this is a maslaha, they do it. We might sometimes think they're quiet, their silence is ilm. Take it from them, be quiet. Don't use your emotions. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هُمْ أَعْلَمُ مِنْكِ. They're more knowledgeable than you. They chose to be silent, then it makes it more of a reason for you to be silent. It makes more of a reason for you to what? To be silent. And not to accuse them and start accusing them. Rahimahumullah, those who have died from amongst those ulama, and from those who live, may Allah protect them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Ahmad rahimahullah, he died fi Rabi' al-Awwal, according to one of the opinions, when the year was 241 Hijriyah. Ahmad used to say, قُولُوا لِأَهْلِ الْبِدَعِ, say to the innovators, بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ يَوْمُ الْجَنَائِزِ. Between us is the day of the janaiz. The day of janaiz, meaning the funeral, this is our. Now inshaAllah ta'ala, we're going to go into the madhab al-hanbali now. We're going to now go into the madhab al-hanbaliya. Ama madhab al-hanbali. The hanbali madhab is a component of the following. Number one. The madhab al-hanbaliyyah is a component of the following. The first one is أَقْوَالُهُ فِي الْكُتُوبِ الْمَعْرُوفَةِ. The books that have the statements of Imam Ahmad رحمه ta'ala. You see some books called مَسَائِلُ Imam Ahmad. Questions have been asked to him. We're going to talk about those books inshallah. Don't worry, we're going to mention them. Al-Imam Ahmad's Masail, the questions that have been put to him, you'll see it there, his fatawa, his verdicts that he gave, his aqwal al-fiqhiyya, his fiqhi opinions, all of them. That's the first component. That's the first thing that Madhab al-Hanbali stands on. Second one is at-takhrij ala aqwali. The second one is, they do takhrij. We mention it, don't worry, just write the word as it is. To do takhrij on the Hanbali Madhab. Extract of the Hanbali madhab. Number three, ijtihadatu ulama al-madhab. So the second one is they extract from the statements of Imam Ahmad something. Good. The third one is, so what's the first one? Imam Ahmad's statements there, just that Ahmad said this. Second one is things that have been extracted from Ahmad's opinions, Ahmad's views, Ahmad's fatawa's verdicts, takhriju ala aqwali. Number three is اجتهادات علماء المذهب. The independent reasoning of the scholars of the Hanbali madhab. The third one is independent reasoning. اجتهادات علماء المذهب. From the scholars of the madhab. Independent reasoning that they've come with. Good. Those are the three things that the Hanbali madhab is a component of. Inshallah ta'ala, I now want to go into the tabaqat ulama'i madhab al-Hanbali. The levels and the stations and the ranks that the scholars categorize the ulama of the Hanbali madhab, how they categorized. The ulama al-madhab al-Hanbali, the scholars of the Hanbali madhab, they are categorized into three levels. The first one are the mutaqaddimun. The mutaqaddimun are the early generation, the forefront. These ones are, the mutaqaddimun are those ones الَّذِينَ اَعْتَنُوا بِجَمْعِ مَا أُثِرَ عَلْ إِمَامِ أَحْمَدِ. They're the ones who gave consideration to transmitting to us what Ahmad said. The mutaqaddimun, all they were trying to do was trying to bring to us what Ahmad said. Good. From the most famous one amongst them is the one who, from the famous one of them is the great Imam Al-Khalal. Khalal, who died in 311 Hijriah. He is the author of the kitab called Al-Jam' Al-Kabir. We're going to be speaking about this, inshallah ta'ala, in these books in details later. وَكَذَلِكَ And also the big book, Al-Khiraqi's kitab. The Mukhtasar Al-Khiraqi. Al-Khiraqi, his book. He died in 334 Hijriah, Al-Khiraqi. He has a Mukhtasar. His Mukhtasar is the one Ibn Qudama explained. His Mukhtasar is the one that Ibn Qudama explained. The Kitab Al-Mughni is a Sharah Al-Mukhtasar Al-Khiraqi. وَبِالْ مُنَاسَبَةِ It's said as Khiraqi. Khiraqi. That's how you say it. He died in 334 Hijriah. Also, Al-Hasan ibn Hamid. He died in 403. He has a kitab called Tahdibu Al-Ajwiba. He has what? Tahdibu Al-Ajwiba. He died in 403 Hijriah. That's the first level of ulama. They're called the what? The mutaqaddimun. The early generation. They're the forefront of the madhab.